And welcome to another edition of Two Steps Ahead Podcast. Two Steps Ahead Podcast, encouraging you to take your passion, make it happen, let yourself be great. I'm Sonny, and I'm coming up on the show a little bit later. We're going to discuss some things in relation to South Dakota Governor Kristi Noem apparently putting down a dog and the backlash she has received because of that. So we're going to talk about some things surrounding that story. But first, I'd like to talk about some comments that Pastor John MacArthur had to say that apparently sparked some backlash from people. His comments having to do with there's no such thing as mental illness and calls PTSD grief. And so let's start with that. Now, Pastor John MacArthur is the pastor of Grace Community Church in Sun Valley, California. He was apparently at a conference or a seminar, something like that, and was asked a question having to do with helping parents navigate America's cultural disaster. So the comments weren't about mental health and mental health illness directly. It just had to do with how can we help kids navigate America's cultural disaster? And of course, in America, a cultural disaster includes things such as mental illness, woke ideology, LGBTQ+, all these different things, cancellations of things we don't like, tearing down statues. Now we're protesting on campuses, all this stuff. And so that was the question. Now, before we delve into it, and I've got his comments I'll play here in a minute, but before we delve into it, two things. First of all, we've talked about mental health illness on the show before, and I've often said that it's not a sign of weakness to go talk to somebody, whether it be a therapist, whether it be a counselor, whether it be a psychiatrist, psychologist, whatever it is. If you need to talk to somebody because you're struggling with some things, by all means, you need to do that. You need to take care of yourself. You need to have good mental health. Mindset is everything. We've talked about that. In fact, if you need more context, you can always go back to our previous episode on mental health. Our most current one is episode 171. You can just do an internet search of Two Steps Ahead Podcast, episode 171, and it'll pop up, or you can go to YouTube. You can go to Rumble. You go to SoundCloud if you want the audio, or anywhere you listen to podcasts, or a website, RadioWarp.com. That's Radio W-A-R-P, RadioWarp.com. And you can search for it and you can find episode 171 and hear about our mental health conversations. So again, I'm not opposed to mental health. In fact, I think if you need to talk to somebody, you should. Two, some statistics from the CDC. According to the CDC, the Center for Disease Control and Prevention, 1 in 5 U.S. adults live with mental health illness. 1 in 5 youth ages 13 to 18 will either currently or at some point during their life have a seriously debilitating mental illness. About 1 in 25 U.S. adults also live with a serious mental illness, such as schizophrenia, bipolar disorder, major depression. So before we get to his comments too, I'm going to take this conversation and maybe push it a little bit further into some areas, because I think that having conversation about things, whether it is like now, for example, we're talking about mental illness. And so what are some causes? What are some helps? What are some symptoms? What are some triggers? You know, things like that. And so we need to kind of have a conversation, whether you agree or not, or what your thoughts are on it or not. And so I want to try to push the envelope a little bit with some of our conversation here today. But let's start off with his comments. So he's at this symposium, we'll call it, and he's asked a question about helping parents navigate America's cultural disaster. And this is what he had to say.
There's no such thing as PTSD. There's no such thing as OCD. There's no such thing as ADHD. Those are noble lies. To basically give the excuse to, in the end of the day, to medicate people. And Big Pharma is in charge of a lot of that. If you understand, take PTSD, for example. What that really is grief. You are fighting a war, you lost your buddies, You have a certain amount of survival guilt because you made it back, they didn't. How do you deal with grief? Grief is a real thing. But grief is part of life. And if you can't navigate grief, you can't live life. But if you clinically define that, you can give them a pill, a series of medications, and they end up in L.A. homeless on the sidewalk.
So his comments include no such thing as PTSD, OCD, ADHD, and he calls them noble lies, which will give people, professionals, Big Pharma, an excuse to medicate people. Of course, Big Pharma equals big money. We've seen that recently with COVID and the vaccine and how Big Pharma made billions of dollars. We see it. How many commercials do you see about wet MD or other things? And I have this pill that you can take, this pharmaceutical. And so that was one part of the comment referring to Big Pharma being able to medicate people. Now he says PTSD is grief and grief is real. And then pills aren't the answer. So there is some truth to what he says as far as there's an underlying root cause of your mental illness in some cases. And PTSD, maybe that is grief. And if you are going to only medicate that grief, then you're just putting a Band-Aid. You're just masking it over. And you're not dealing with the root cause of the problem. He also cites some arguments presented by clinical psychologist Bruce E. Levine, who I guess has a book, A Profession Without Reason. And then there's the other book, The Myth of Mental Illness, by now deceased Hungarian-American psychiatrist Thomas Szasz. Maybe you're familiar with those. I am not. But he urged parents not to believe in noble lies. I guess noble lies is what Thomas Szasz categorized that would give Big Pharma the reasons to medicate your kids. So, for example, PTSD is a mental illness requiring medication. I guess that would be a noble lie because in actuality, PTSD would be grief. And instead of medicating grief, you solve the issue or the root cause of how can you solve grief. And I don't know if you can. And again, I guess it depends on if you're using the war analogy, that might take a number of years. So he's citing some other people's information by his comments. And you can look it up and you can do your own investigation and your own research to see more about what he says and what some of this has to do. But he puts out there and he basically just says that when you're talking about these medications, you're dealing with doing away with self-responsibility, okay? So he says, and the major noble lie is there is such a thing as mental illness. Again, this comes from Thomas Szasz writing in his book. When he says there's no such thing as PTSD, no such thing as OCD, ADHD, those are the noble lies that basically give the excuse for Big Pharma to medicate your child, for doctors to medicate your child. Now, there's a lot of different psychotic or maybe psychiatric disabilities out there. And so not one set of events or not one set of incidences like going to war and getting PTSD, there probably wasn't just one event. It's probably a series of events that caused it, right? You're probably going to war. You're seeing buddies die. You're dealing with the extreme conditions, the very threat that you might not make it and having to rectify that in your mind. And so it goes on and on. Now, according to the Department of Veterans Affairs, over 6 million veterans served in fiscal year 2021. About 10% of men, 19% of women were diagnosed with PTSD. So you have that going for you. And so then John MacArthur went on to say that, you know, if you're doing with PTSD, you give them a pill, you medicate them, they end up homeless on the street. We've talked about homeless veterans before too, and that's a very real thing. And so what you've got going on is you've got a lot of issues. And I've always said it, there's not one size fits all answer. But the grief that he took, I think, is a little bit unwarranted from the standpoint that if you really look deeper, see, we don't look at things deeper. We just look at, oh, he said mental health. Well, he never really said mental health didn't exist. He said that maybe there's some things we need to look at so that we're not just automatically medicating kids or not automatically medicating people and masking over the problem. At least that's what I got out of it. So basically, it comes down to making right choices. You've got all kinds of influences on people. And if you start to blame it on something else, these choices, these behaviors, then you start giving excuse for somebody to not have to check their behavior or be responsible for their behavior. You just medicate it, you mask it, and you move on. And he goes on to talk more about kids too. This is what he had to say now about the kids aspect. So again, the question had to do with helping parents navigate the cultural disaster here in America. And so those were his first comments, and he follows up with these comments here.
This is in regard to children, it's the most deadly thing that's been unleashed on children, medication. We're trying to make clear to parents that behavior is essentially the result of choices that kids make. And if you parent them properly, they'll make right choices. But if you blame it on something other than their choices, and you identify them as having something they can't do anything about but medicate it, you literally are turning your child into a potential, not only a potential drug addict, but maybe a potential criminal, because they never learn how to navigate life in a socially acceptable way.
So behavior is a result of choice. Proper parenting would address a lot of that, and that's so true. I don't care what you say. You can be in the schools. If you've been in any type of school environment for any period of time, it doesn't have to be that long, but if you've been in a school environment for any period of time lately, you will realize that a lot of behaviors stem from bad parenting, period. Teachers will work all week on disciplinary issues, on proper behavior, and they will make progress. And then Friday comes, and when they go home for the weekend, it's not reinforced. Kids come back Monday, worse off than they were when they came back the previous week on Monday, and you got to start over and over and over. Bad parenting includes allowing your kid to have devices, especially elementary grade levels, too early, too often, too much. Their influences are driving their behaviors. They see things, they throw a tantrum, they get what they want. So those tantrums then come to the classroom. So there are a lot of truths to what he said about behavior is a result of choice, and proper parenting would indeed stem a lot of that. But instead, we just want to pass the blame. And he says, don't pass the blame. Find out what the root cause is and treat it. And medication is not the answer. Pills are dangerous. We are turning our kids into something other than good quality kids. Now, that's not all cases, obviously. A lot of great parents out there, a lot of great teachers, a lot of great people doing a lot of great things. But when you look at it from the perspective of mental health, is it really? I mean, I've seen kids on, well, before they're kind of wound up, they're whatever they are, and then they take their meds, and it sure calms them down, but it changes who they are. It changes their personality. It changes their being. It changes their soul. And now the kid is listless, just moping through life, not himself, because we're just trying to mask a problem. mask ADHD. And sure, there's a lot of kids that can't sit still. Well, that's society. There's a lot of adults that can't sit still. A lot of adults' attention span of a gnat. Society has changed. And unfortunately, it's not changed for the good. However, when you have a kid that's bouncing off the walls, full of spirit, and then you medicate, and now it's a kind of a listless zombie going through life, and we say, oh, he's calm, she's calm, so we don't have to worry about these episodes. That's a good thing. Well, it's not. It's hurting the kids. It's affecting them negatively. But Big Pharma is making money. The problem is solved. No hyperactive kid. No longer telling the kid to sit down and be quiet, sit down and be quiet, sit down and be quiet. See, it takes a very creative, imaginative, and a lot of time for a teacher to do that. And if you have 20, 25 kids, how can you do that? If you're in special ed and you have 6, 7, 8 kids like this that you have to deal with, how do you do it? You find the path of least resistance. And there's a lot of great teachers that go after that. But then there are some that push the medication because it's the path of least resistance at the cost of the kid. So when you look at this mental health issue, is it real? Again, John MacArthur got blasted for saying, at least according to the headlines, that mental health didn't exist. But when you listen to his comments, it makes it sound like, well, there's a root cause to something. What is that root cause? Are you going to treat that root cause, such as PTSD being grief? Are you going to try to resolve that grief, treat the grief? Or are we just going to give them pills, send them on their way? Because see, that's the other thing. If you're going to treat the grief of PTSD, you've got to spend time, effort, and energy with that person. Just like you're going to the dentist, you got to dig out the cavity, right? They just don't cover it up with the filling. They dig out the decay, and then they put the new filling in. Or if you have a root canal, they have to take out the roots because your tooth is so bad. Then they fill it back up, and now you've got a solid tooth. But there was some decay and corruption in that tooth that needed to be extracted. And when you're dealing with people's personalities and dealing with people's issues, there might be times when you have to go in and you have to dig out all that, get rid of all that negativity, all that bad junk. And then you can fill it up with the good stuff and get a new person. It takes a lot of effort, a lot of money. Well, maybe not a lot of money, but a lot of effort, a lot of time, and a lot of patience. Or you can just throw some money at somebody with some pills, let the pills do the talking, and call it a day. What do you think would be better? I want to talk about something here, an article that I picked up from, I don't know where I got it, but it came out in 2023 by David Feldman, a professor of counseling, psychology at Santa Clara University. And it's pretty interesting. But before I do that, so we have John MacArthur talking about mental illness, talking about at least what I interpreted as there's a root cause to a problem. And instead of just medicating and giving it to Big Pharma and having that pharmaceutical effect on society, maybe we should treat things. And again, it's a short answer to a very big question, mental illness. And the question wasn't even specific on mental illness. The question was, how can parents navigate America's cultural disaster? So with that, you might know Jordan Peterson. Here's what Jordan Peterson has to say.
And you know, one of the things that's very interesting about being a psychologist is that what you learn if you're going to be a psychologist is that people come to you with mental illnesses. And that's almost never true. People come to you because their lives are so damn complicated, they cannot stay on top of them in any way that doesn't make it look like they're just going to get more complicated. And so then that causes symptoms. You know, it's like, it's this old idea, sort of a metaphor for genetic susceptibility. Take a balloon and blow it up until it's beyond its tolerance. It's going to blow out at the weakest point. Well, that's sort of what a genetic susceptibility is. If I just keep adding complexity on top of you, at some point you'll blow out at your weakest point. You know, maybe you'll get physiologically ill. Maybe you'll start drinking. Maybe you'll develop an anxiety disorder. Maybe you'll get OCD. Maybe you'll get depressed. Whatever, there'll be something about you that's the weakest point. And if I just push, that's where you'll blow out. So that's a mental illness, but those things almost never just happen. Sometimes, but not very often. Usually people have just been hammered like two or three different ways, and then they collapse in the direction of their biological weakness, and then maybe you put them back together, but it's almost always a complexity-related phenomena rather than a mental illness-related phenomena.
So there are Jordan Peterson talking about a complexity issue problem and not necessarily a mental health issue problem. So again, a little bit more from somebody else. When he sees people and patients and people come to him, a lot of times it's complex. It means complexity of life. Things happen. And more and more and more things happen to you, the less you can take it. And pretty soon it's going to blow out your personality in the weakest way, whether that be drinking, whether that be anxiety, depression, whatever it is, your psyche is going to break at its weakest point and cause a blowout. But people come with mental illness. Well, he says that's not true. They come with problems that then lead to mental illness. Life is so complicated, they can't stay on top of things. Things get more complicated. You look at the now, I can't take anymore, blowout. Symptoms show up. Anxiety, stressing, depression, drinking then, whatever your weakest point is. He went on to say that you're getting hammered two or three different ways. This happens. Maybe it's a breakup, a loss of a job. Puppy dies, and you're getting hammered with things that are coming on. You know, those obstacles of life that we have to overcome in order to raise the standard and bring out our inner greatness, right? But sometimes those waves just keep hitting us and hitting us and hitting us, and we tumble over and we think we're going to drown and we have a blowout. It's the complexity of all those things because we think, how are we going to get over this? Because all we see is the now and all the problems, and we don't see what the future might hold. And so we have the blowout. But he did allude to the fact that mental illness might not always, he did say sometimes. So there are, like we've talked about before, there are reasons or medical conditions or whatever it is. I don't even know if sometimes the professions, you know, the mental health professionals know what some of these mental health issues like schizophrenia and some of these things come from. I have a theory that could suggest where those things come from, coming up in a moment, so stay tuned. But again, Jordan Peterson kind of alluding to the fact that there's some underlying issues to that mental illness, and it's the complexities of life, the things that happen in life, and then our psyche blows out its weakest point. So here's that article I was talking about. Some psychologists say calling emotional difficulties illnesses is nonsense. Is mental illness real, according to David Feldman back in 2023? And again, he refers to, and this was just completely ironic, but he refers to the psychiatrist Thomas Szasz as well. And that wasn't planned this way, just happened to see this article, start reading about it, and I was like, wow, it's a good article. And then Thomas Szasz's name popped up, and I'm like, coincidence or correlation? And again, it's the myth of mental illness. But it talks about instead of, so this is the article, Feldman talking. Instead of holding people personally and ethically responsible for their actions, doctors attempt to treat the person often with medication. On the other hand, people argue that mental disorders are real, as physical diseases are real, like the flu and so forth, and diagnosing them allows people to get the care they need. So that's the juxtaposition. So what do you do? So to fully understand the issue, he says, it's important to consider how mental disorders are diagnosed. Now, if you're a mental health professional, don't come at me if this is wrong. This is the dude saying it, not me. Talk to him. But you can let me know, and I could clarify. But according to Feldman, he says that you have the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders, the DSM for short, the Bible of Mental Illness. It's in its fifth edition, by the way. If you were to visit a psychologist's office, one of the first things he or she would do is assess your symptoms. After a thorough interview, the psychologist would sit down, crack open the DSM, the Bible of Mental Illness, and determine whether your symptoms met the criteria of any of the disorders it contains. Symptoms, let's go match the symptoms to the disorders and see what you got. Now, to qualify for a diagnosis, Feldman says, in the, or I guess in the major Let's say if you had major depressive disorder, for example, to qualify for a diagnosis, you would have to have at least 5 of the 9 symptoms listed in the DSM, the Bible of illness, mental illness. These symptoms must last for at least 2 weeks and they must impair your functioning. So if you were to complain of a few weeks of being intensely sad, maybe loss of interest in things that previously gave you pleasure, staying in bed all day, feeling completely worthless, contemplating suicide, difficulty concentrating, then you might be diagnosed with depression. But again, what if you break up with somebody and you're depressed? May that cause a diagnosis? I guess it depends on how bad the breakup was, how long it lasts. But is that really mental illness, or are you just struggling with a current event? What about a loss of a big game? You're an athlete. Olympics are coming up. You train for 4 years or your whole life, and you miss out, and you're depressed. You're sad. And that goes for a while. Is that a mental illness, or are you just struggling with the fact of disappointment that you didn't win? You can answer that question. But what's important to note in the diagnosis, that the diagnosis is determined primarily by symptoms when it comes to mental health. If a patient has these symptoms and they impair functioning, he or she is generally getting that diagnosis. So you look at the symptoms and then you diagnose it. Unlike other diseases where, like the flu and some things like that, outside invaders like bacteria will infiltrate your body and get you sick. Mental disorders are usually defined by their symptoms rather than their causes. So physical illnesses, what's the cause of it? A bacteria, a virus, whatever. Mental health, it's the symptoms. Sadness, not getting out of bed, not eating, things like that, suicidal thoughts. He goes on to say, because mental disorders are generally identified on the basis of their symptoms, a mental health diagnosis doesn't necessarily explain a person's symptoms. It only describes them. Again, what's the root cause? You've got depression. Why? You're not eating. Why? You're not getting out of bed. Why? Well, instead of the why, we have the you're not getting out of bed, you're not eating, you're sad, you meet this criteria, here's some pills. I guess that's the difference between the two. A diagnosis, though, does accomplish two very important things. Feldman says it helps. Well, in fact, he only lists one. He left out the second. But he goes, it helps direct the therapist towards the treatment so that you can fix the disorder or help the disorder. He goes, why reinvent the wheel? You have these symptoms. You figure out what the symptoms are, what the diagnosis is. You can go to the books and see how to treat them, and you're not reinventing the wheel every time. So his conclusion, mental illness, is it real? Yes, but we need to understand their limitations. They're generally not external invaders of the body, like viruses or bacteria. They don't necessarily absolve people of responsibility for their actions, but they are useful descriptions of the very real suffering that people can experience. Even given its limitations, the concept of mental illness has helped to structure the mental health field for decades. It helps connect people to the care they need. So it connects people to the care they need, and it's unlikely to go away anytime soon. So again, you have John MacArthur, you have Jordan Peterson, and you have David Feldman, professor of counseling psychology at Santa Clara University, talking about that when it comes to mental health, perhaps there are some root causes that are causing the mental health. And maybe we need to look at those root causes and try to fix the root causes or address the root causes and not just medicate. So when you go back to John MacArthur's comments, when the headline said there's no such thing as PTSD and mental health isn't real, according to the headlines, if you look a little bit deeper instead of just knee-jerk reaction to a headlines, what you're going to find out is that there's some truth to what is being said. Big pharma is quick to make a buck. Let's just medicate. Path of easy resistance, you know, the easiest way to go, easiest path to take is to medicate instead of working on the problem the underlying cause to try to help. Better parenting. ADHD, maybe it's better parenting. Your kid's out of control, better parenting. Take away the iPad. Get some discipline. PTSD, maybe there is some grief. I'm not saying medication can't help in the processes. You know, you think about, let's take high blood pressure. High blood pressure, you get some high blood pressure pills to lower it. Good thing, right? But do you stop there? Well, you shouldn't. What should you do? Address the issue. Do you need to lose weight? Do you need to exercise? Do you need to change your diet? See, it all encompasses for a plan. And that's what's missing. If there's the pills involved with big pharma and medication, that could be good. But what else are you doing? And again, it's not a one size fits all, and not everybody is in the wrong. But I think the people that had the knee-jerk reaction are the ones that probably suffered from something. And so it hits home to them and they can't see past their involvement in it. The other thing that I think mental health illness has to deal with is what Pastor Jack Hibbs has to say. You know, we've talked a lot of times about spirituality, Christianity, biblical principles, things like that on the show as well. And here, Pastor Jack Hibbs talks about mental health and perhaps the demonic or the demon possession aspect of it.
So the issue of mental illness, question, why is it so rampant now in the world? It's off the charts. What's going on? Is it real? Well, of course it's real, but we have to be careful that it's not some blanket answer to that. There is the reality that the Bible speaks about regarding demonic possession. People who have been radically demonically disturbed. We know that people are mentally ill because of worry and fear has completely controlled their lives and taken them over. We know that there's mental illness because of sicknesses and diseases and infection. We know that. So there's various manifestations of mental illness. Yes, it's real. And some need medication. But let's not throw everything into one bucket. More than ever today, according to the Bible, we are living in days that Jesus said are the last days with demonic manifestations. We need to know truth, and we need to know discernment on what is what.
Need to know truth, need to know discernment. Let's not throw everything into one bucket. There's real issues out there that might need medication. But let's look at the truth. Let's look at discernment. Various manifestations of mental illness. Some need meds, but maybe not everything. Do you need meds because you worry all the time? I don't know. Do you need meds because you're fearful all the time? I've known some people that were so fearful of COVID because it was instilled in them that they did not literally did not leave their house for over a year. That's how fearful they were. Eventually they, through some encouragement, start to get out of the house and realize I'm missing out on a lot of things. And now it's kind of, I think, life back to normal for them. Would that require medication? That fearfulness? Or is that just a cause of maybe some propaganda? If you're worrying a lot, does that require medication? Or maybe does it require some other things to try to obtain inner peace? Mental illness comes from diseases, infection, and sickness. But then there's also other forms of mental health that are problematic because of other symptoms that might not require. And then, of course, there's the demonic influence, demon possession. Bible talks about, you know, wrestling not with flesh and blood, but against principalities, powers, things in the spiritual world, that it's not a fleshly battle, but a spiritual battle. So again, you might not subscribe to religion. That's fine. You don't have to. But if you do, it's something to think about, something to put out there. So could something like schizophrenia, hearing voices, be something of the demonic, be something of a demon possession? Could be. It's definitely not normal. Is it treated with medication? Sure. How successful? I guess you'd have to do the research to see. But when it comes down to it, There is no blanket answer to mental health. You have to look at it individually. So when John MacArthur says there's no mental health, according to the headlines, no PTSD, just grief, according to the headlines, and everyone panics and throws shade on him. Well, if you look deeper, you would see that there's a root cause to some of these, just like Jordan Peterson, just like Jack Hibbs, just like David Feldman had said. And we need to address those issues and not just mask it with medication. With kids, don't just mask it with medication and cover it up. You've got to fix the issue if you want to fix the person. And sometimes that requires time, effort, energy, a lot of time, a lot of effort, a lot of energy. But Big Pharma is strong. They want the billions. So they push the medication. And you see the commercials all the time with all this medication for everything that I've never even heard of before, like wet MD. I don't even know what that is. A doctor standing in sprinklers? I don't know. But again, look at the core issues and see what the problem is and address that problem and get a little deeper. And then if you do need to talk to somebody, by all means, go after the treatment that you want. Don't be afraid. Don't hesitate. If you need somebody and you have no idea, reach out. twostepsaheadpodcast@gmail.com. TWO, twostepsaheadpodcast@gmail.com. And I can put you in touch with a couple people that might be able to help you. So don't dismiss mental health. It is real, like Jack Hibbs says, but there is no blanket answer to it. Not a one size fits all. Mental illness can stem from many different things. Some might require more in-depth treatment with medication, and maybe others you can get away without the medication. Know the truth, know discernment. If you know the truth and you use discernment, you will more likely come up with the right answer. Now, another thing that has happened recently in the news is that you have Governor Kristi Noem from South Dakota, apparently for some unknown reason, decided to write in a book, I guess, that she killed a dog, a puppy. Don't know what in the world she's thinking. Know your audience, and nowhere in the world would the audience say that is okay. So tremendous backlash. Okay, fine. But is it really valid? And the outrage, is it really real? Well, first off, let's do a man on the street. People, would you save your dog or would you save a stranger?
So if a bus was hurtling down the street,
yes,
and it was going to hit either,
yes,
a foreign tourist or one of your dogs, and you could only save one, which would you save?
My dog.
And you can only save one. Who do you save?
I gotta save my dog, Butterball.
My dog.
I gotta save my dog. I'm sorry. My dog.
Either a foreign tourist or Molly. Who do you save?
Molly.
What do you think the human would say?
Well, they would be hit.
What country?
My dog, obviously.
French tourist.
French tourist, yes, to Molly.
Even though it's a human, but my dog's part of the family, so.
So if it was a distant cousin or your dog, who would you choose? The bus is coming real fast, buddy.
Okay, I guess I would say maybe the cousin.
What about the human?
I'd make an attempt for him right after, Stewie. Good.
Either a foreign tourist or Waldo, and you can only save one. Who do you save?
Definitely Waldo. Not a question.
Why? Wait, what do you think?
I don't know.
Which do you save?
Foreign tourist, easy.
A distant cousin or your dog.
Oh, wait, no, so, I'm sorry. I would rather save my dog than the foreign tourist.
Probably the dog, because a distant cousin, I probably don't know him as well as I know my dog.
What if it was your best friend or the dog?
I hate to say it, but the dog.
What if it's a distant cousin?
Nah.
Best friend or Molly?
Teresa.
Wow, do we?
She can save herself.
Do either a foreign tourist or foster, and you could only save one. Who do you save?
The foreign tourist.
Why the tourist?
Because I like human life.
Do you love your dog?
Yeah.
And you would still choose the human?
Yeah.
Can I give you a hug, sir?
Okay.
Now, whether or not that video is staged to be that way is irrelevant, but it's true. People would rather save their dog than a stranger, a best friend, a distant cousin, a French tourist. I mean, there's some pretty callous remarks there about human life. Well, they'd be hit anyways. What country? Maybe the country depends on where they're from. Even though they're human, the dog is part of the family. Got to save the part of the family. Save the dog over a distant cousin. Save the dog over a best friend. She can save herself. And out of all that, only one person picked a stranger. So, pretty sad to think that we've gotten to the point in society where we're going to pick an animal and save over human life. So Christy Noem gets pushback. Pushback about killing her dog. Again, why she would write that, I have no idea. Stupidest thing you could do. Because you can't kill dogs, as we just learned. Got to kill people, you can, but you can't kill dogs. But here's the thing. The faux outrage that people had about her killing her dog, when you are the very people pro-choice, my body, my choice, you are the ones that are in favor of killing human life. And yet you're going to be outraged over the dog. Unbelievable that that's where we've come to society. Sure, dogs are valuable. Sure, animal lives are valuable, and we need to treat them the best we can. But over human life? Are you kidding me? So people with their faux outrage, oh, she killed the dog. You know what? Save it. Because you are all for the killing of a human. Tommy Kearns shared a personal and devastating account of his daughter's abortion. In a deeply moving moment during a no abortion, no exception tour at Florida International University, he talked about the abortion that his ex now, I don't know if they were married or if it was just a girlfriend situation. Maybe he says it in the comment. But he drove 3 hours to make this speech, and he recounted the desperate pleas to the mother of his child not to proceed with the abortion. And despite their 5-month debate and his unconditional love for both the child and the mother, his pleas went in vain.
Before I get into my question, I just wanted to say my daughter's name is Clementine. She was 5 months along when she was aborted in New Jersey. My daughter was healthy. I begged her mother not to go through with the abortion. For 5 months, we went back and forth. I don't hate my ex. I love her. And I'm working on forgiving her. She was confused. She was uncertain. And she had doubts. Mike Tyson has doubts before he gets into a ring. This was an option, and she took that option, and she regrets it now. Why do you think, and this is just a thought that just came into my head, why do you think that people dehumanize my Clementine? Why wasn't she human enough for people to help me mourn? Why wasn't she human enough for people to talk about? My mother was given birth too prematurely at 5 months. My daughter was 5 months. I didn't get to say goodbye to my daughter. I didn't know about the abortion until after it happened. I begged her not to do the appointment. She told me that she canceled it. My daughter was 5 months, and she was ripped apart. My daughter doesn't get a funeral. My daughter doesn't get respect. As my friend asked, yeah, medical testing on a healthy baby. Why? My girlfriend didn't pay for the abortion. The clinic did. How much money did they make off of my daughter's body? How many other babies did the doctor kill since she's been dead? This has been a month and 3 days. This happened March 12th and 13th. My daughter was conceived October 25th. She was supposed to be born July 20th. My daughter was a person. My daughter is an angel. And I pray for her every single day. I talk to her. I still feel like she's there. I feel like on July 20th, my daughter is going to be there. She doesn't get a funeral. I have her sonogram picture the first time I heard her heartbeat. And I bring this up to people and I say, well, she had a heartbeat. Wasn't she a person? And I'm being told she's a fetus, which, by the way, everybody, that's Latin for offspring. Okay. So I don't know why we're speaking Latin. I speak English. And my daughter not only matters, but I do not want my daughter to be forgotten. I want my daughter's story to be talked about. I want her to be remembered.
A lot of great questions. He wants answers. Pro-choice person, can you answer them? What do you say when he begs the mom not to have an abortion? Because perhaps she is confused and has doubts. Well, I'm sure your response would be her body, her choice. A father denied parental rights? Then you all bitch about deadbeat dads. So why is it okay in this case for the mother to abort the child without the father's consent, and then you turn around and bitch about deadbeat dads? Maybe you should just suck it up. Cold? Is that a cold statement to make? Well, that's what we're dealing with. You're dealing with cold and calculated moves on the part of people that are in favor of abortion, because why was Clementine dehumanized? Why was she not human enough? Why can't he say goodbye to Clementine, not have a funeral? Why is there no respect for Clementine? Because you don't care. His daughter was, in fact, a person. And for those people that say the baby inside the womb is not a baby, okay, well, that's something from the 1960s that needs to die, because that is a lie. Have you seen 3D sonograms lately? Have you heard the heartbeat like this father did, hearing Clementine's heartbeat? So we know it's real. And so here's a father who lost his daughter, had no choice, didn't even know it was going to happen. He said he had unconditional love for the baby and the mother. Now he's split from the mom. So now not only is the baby gone, but the relationship is destroyed. No funerals. Healthy baby. His mom was born at 5 months, premature, and survived. It's pretty sad. And then you have the outrage, the audacity to be outraged over a puppy being killed. And this is the type of thing that you support and you think it's okay. Yeah, how much money? It's a multi-billion dollar industry, the abortion industry. And now you're saying that killing a puppy is bad and that person needs to be... Some of you had some pretty vile things to say about what should happen to Kristi Noem, the governor, for killing her dog. But yet we've seen from the man on the street that dog life is way more valued than human life. And as a Christian, how can you support that? How can you support the killing of God's creation? How can you play God? Now, I'm not talking about people that make the choice, because just like anything else, we're fallible people. And just like mental health, we're going to have all these problems come our way all of a sudden, like Jordan Peterson said. Complexities are coming upon us. Unwanted pregnancy, we've got this, we've got that, we got that. What am I going to do? What am I going to do? Blowout. And the blowout answer is get rid of the problem. The problem is the abortion. But you don't see 4, 5, 6, 10, 20, 30 years down the road what that child could be like and all the things that you miss out on, the birthdays, the memories, the graduations, the ball games, the grandkids. You don't think of all that, because in the moment you see problem after problem after problem, and then you have your blowout. And people applaud it. Applaud the fact that you killed your child and are disgusted in horror that a dog was put down. The father goes on, talk more about it, and has some more serious questions he would like answered.
But she was a lot more than that for me. For 5 months, I'm told by my friends, I'm crying over somebody I never met before. I'm told by people, well, she wasn't even a person. She was just a fetus. She wasn't even a baby. She wasn't fully developed. My daughter was still growing. And my relationship with my daughter was going to grow for the rest of our lives. Why isn't my daughter human enough for people to care? Why isn't my daughter woman enough for her to have a body and for her to have a choice?
Can you answer that? Can you answer his questions? Why isn't my daughter human enough to care? Why isn't my daughter woman enough to have a body and a choice? Answer it. He deserves an answer. He deserves an answer as to why you are so cold, calculated, and callous to his predicament of losing his child, Clementine, and yet you're outraged about a puppy being put down. Answer his question. Why? You can't, because maybe you are cold, calculated, and calloused. Maybe you need to check your... What type of society are we living in where we value an animal, a dog, over human life? Will people sit there and, will you save your best friend? No, I'm going to save my dog. Will you save a distant relative? No, I'm going to save my dog. Will you save a stranger? No, I'm going to save my dog. And then you have the comments that come after that. Well, she'd be hit anyways. Well, the dog is a part of the family. She can save herself. It's unbelievable to the point where when you look at society as a whole, you understand why it is we're going down the path we're going down. You think about October 7th, 2023, when Hamas invaded Israel, slaughtered all those people, raped and tortured and killed. We would not be in the state we are in today if Hamas had just stayed home. Where are we at now? Turmoil. All kinds of people promoting a pro-terrorist, a pro-anti-life group, taking the sides of a terroristic anti-life group. Is it no surprise? Now, you know these people would be hell-bent if Hamas was killing animals. They would not tolerate it. They're killing puppies. They'd be the worst creatures in the world, Hamas. But because they're killing people, but because they're killing Jews, it's okay. Let them. We support them. In fact, we support them to the point where we're going to make demands on our colleges for things that we didn't even know or care about until someone paid us or told us we had to care about them. I mean, where have we come in society? Where have we come to the point where Clementine isn't woman enough to have a body or have a choice? Where Clementine isn't human enough to care? Where Clementine is discarded and disposed of, and people celebrate and cheer that? It's kind of a sad place. And then what about the mom? Like the father said, he's working on forgiving. Tough thing to do. What do you think the mom's going through? He said regret. Depends on the influences around her, I guess. And that's the thing that I think people should do research on, regret. We've done many shows on abortion, and there are many issues, many reasons. One main reason, well, most of them are elective. Like, we don't know the reason why Clementine was aborted, but a healthy baby, no issues. So it wasn't that. It wasn't the life of the child or the mother. It wasn't rape or incest. It was elective. A majority, 99% of abortions are elective. The number one person, typically, not always, but typically, is the father of the baby pushing, because it's probably a baby that shouldn't be there because of the relationship. Maybe it was an affair or some other thing. As someone once said, it's the politician, the celebrity, the bigwigs get out of jail free card. That's why we keep it. Because a lot of powerful people fooling around doing things they shouldn't be doing get their get out of jail free card. So there's many, many, many components to it. Multi-billion dollar industry. is probably Tops. People push it because they're making money off of it. He asked the question, how much money did the clinic make off my daughter? Should he not? Not that he would want it, but why does the clinic get the money? If they paid for it, they get to sell the body parts, they get the money. Whole thing is messed up. And that's the world we live in today. Are you okay with that? Or do you find it disgusting? Maybe even evil? Or as Jack Hibbs says, maybe even demonic? It's a question you have to ask. This is Two Steps Ahead Podcast, encouraging you to take your passion, make it happen, let yourself be great. Check us out on our website, radiowarp.com. That's radio, W-A-R-P, radiowarp.com. You can click on the Two Steps Ahead Podcast logo and see all of our video of the shows pop up. You can go back and check episode 171 on mental health. You go back and check what we talked about on many different issues, including abortion, including animals. We've done extensive interviews or extensive shows on the value of animals over people. So again, you can check it all out. You can click the orange bar across our page that says SoundCloud and takes you to the audio version. You can listen anywhere you listen to podcasts. There's also some other things you can listen to on our website as well, other podcasts and music shows. So some good stuff. You can check us out on social media, TWO, Two Steps Ahead Podcast on Facebook, on Instagram, post clips and other things there. So we're pretty easy to find. If you need to reach out, you can. TwoStepsAheadPodcast@gmail.com. That's T-W-O, TwoStepsAheadPodcast@gmail.com. Reach out. If you need help and you don't know where to turn to, send an email. If I can't help you, I can connect you with somebody that can or try to push you in the right direction. If you feel like you're alone and you need a voice, send me an email. If you feel like you're having mental health issues and you don't know who to talk to, I can refer you to some people. Obviously, if it's important and you're really feeling like you're going to hurt yourself, call 911 or the National Suicide Hotline. But reach out to somebody. You don't have to do it alone. You don't have to go alone. If you've done something that you regret, maybe you did have an abortion, and now you regret it like this mother did, it doesn't have to define you. You can overcome it. Don't know if you ever get past it, but it doesn't have to define who you are. And there's healing that can come from it. So again, reach out. TWO, twostepsheadpodcast@gmail.com. Our website, radiowarp.com. That's radio, W-A-R-P.com. Or you can just do an internet search, TWO, Two Steps Ahead Podcast, and we pop up. So when you look at things going on in society, if you would ask the question, what if you were the person that had to be saved and they chose their pet and you died and you were the best friend, how would that make you feel? What if it was between you and a pet, someone else's pet, and they chose the pet? How would you feel? Would you feel worthless? Would you be asking the questions, why aren't I human enough to be saved? Why aren't I human enough to still be alive? Why didn't you care about me enough to save me? All those people in that video saving their pet over the human, what if they were the ones that were in peril and somebody else picked their pet? I bet if they were the ones in peril, they would be hoping that the stranger would pick them and be highly disappointed if they picked their pet. The question comes down to, who would you pick? Two Steps Ahead Podcast, encouraging you to take your passion, make it happen, let yourself be great. I'm Son Edom. Hey, thanks for listening. Do tell a friend. And until next time, God bless.